dum dum, deedle dum dum, deedle dum dum, deedle dum dum. There was a turtle by the name of Bert, and Bert the turtle was very alert. When danger threatened him, he never got hurt. He knew just what to do. He ducked and covered, ducked and covered.
He did what we all must learn to do.
You and you
and you
and you.
Duck and cover.
Be sure and remember what Bert the Turtle just did, friends, because every one of us must remember to do the same thing. That's what this film is all about. Duck and cover.
This is an official civil defense film produced in cooperation with the Federal Civil Defense Administration and in consultation with the Safety Commission of the National Education Association.
Produced by Archer Productions, Incorporated. Hey, Bert, come on out and meet all these nice people, please. Oh, all right. We really can't blame you. You see, Bert is a very, very careful fellow. When there's danger, this is the way he keeps from being hurt. Sometimes it even saves his life. That's why these children are practicing to duck and cover just as you do in your school. We all know the atomic bomb is very dangerous. Since it may be used against us, we must get ready for it, just as we are ready for many other dangers that are around us all the time.
Since the bombings of Hiroshima and Nagasaki, people in the United States and around the world reacted to the atomic bomb through a variety of emotions, from joy and hope to devastation and fear, and many other emotions. People have used cultural expressions to convey these sentiments. These cultural expressions manifested into a phenomenon known as atomic culture. Atomic culture established itself in popular culture such as film, music, and fashion, as well as literature, poetry, and theater. Atomic culture is still today prevalent in our society, becoming so ordinary that the extent to which the bomb has permeated society is not even noticed. Nuclear weapons have been used twice in war, both times by the United States against Japan near the end of World War II. Since then, nuclear weapons have been detonated over 2,000 times for testing and demonstration. Only a few nations possess such weapons or are suspected of seeking them. The only countries known to have detonated nuclear weapons and acknowledged possessing them are the United States, the Soviet Union, or later Russia, the United Kingdom, France, China, India, Pakistan, and North Korea. Interestingly, South Africa is the only country to have independently developed and then dismantled its nuclear weapons. Now, there are two basic types of nuclear weapons. Those that derive the majority of their energy from nuclear fission reactions alone, and those that use fission reactions to begin nuclear fusion reactions that produce a large amount of the total energy output. All existing nuclear weapons derive some of their explosive energy from nuclear fission reactions. Weapons whose explosive output is exclusively from fission reactions are commonly referred to as atomic bombs or A-bombs. This has long been noted as something of a misnomer, as their energy actually comes from the nucleus of the atom, just as it does with fusion weapons. In fission weapons, a mass of fissile material, which is enriched uranium or plutonium, is forced into supercriticality, allowing an exponential growth of nuclear chain reactions, either by shooting one piece of subcritical material into another, which is the gun method, or by compression of a subcritical sphere or cylinder of fissile material using chemically fueled explosive lenses. The latter approach, which is the implosion method, is more sophisticated than the gun method. A mushroom cloud is a distinctive mushroom-shaped thermogenesis cloud of debris, smoke, and usually condensed water vapor resulting from a large explosion. The effect is most commonly associated with a nuclear explosion, but any sufficiently energetic detonation of deflagration or deflagration will produce the same effect. The atomic bomb cloud over Nagasaki, Japan, was described in the Times of London of the 13th of August 1945 as a huge mushroom cloud of smoke and dust. On 9 September 1945, the New York Times published an eyewitness account of the Nagasaki bombing written by William Lawrence, who was the official newspaper correspondent of the Manhattan Project. He wrote that the bomb produced a pillar of purple fire, out of the top of which came a giant mushroom that increased the height of the pillar to a total of 45,000 feet. During the Operation Crossroads nuclear bomb tests at Bikini Atoll in mid-1946, the first nuclear weapon test since the Trinity test, the blasts were described as having a cauliflower cloud, but a reporter there also spoke of the mushroom, now the common symbol of the atomic age. Mushrooms have traditionally been associated both with life and death, food and poison, making them a more powerful symbolic connection than a cauliflower cloud. The term mushroom cloud would permanently be used to describe an atomic blast from the 1950s onwards. The dawning of the atomic age also brought about new moralistic questions about how nuclear power was to be utilized. The term tickling the dragon's tail refers to a technique that allowed Manhattan Project physicist Dr. Louis Slotin to calculate critical mass, which is the mass at which an atomic chain reaction occurs. This calculation was necessary for the detonation of a nuclear weapon. On the 21st of May 1946, Slotin suffered a fatal dose of radiation while he demonstrated the technique of critical assembly and other studies and measurements to another scientist. He would die 9 days later. Now, this cover of Time magazine's 1 July 1946 issue shows a caricature of world-renowned physicist Albert Einstein in front of a depiction of a nuclear blast with Einstein's famous E equals mc squared equation inscribed into the mushroom cloud. This equation opened the door that allowed for the harvesting of nuclear energy and ultimately for the building of nuclear weapons. The equation, and by implication, Einstein, has therefore become synonymous with the nuclear age. Einstein is depicted as Prometheus, the ancient Greek Titan god of fire, who stole fire from Mount Olympus and gave it to humankind. The Trinity test was the first detonation of a nuclear weapon, which led J. Robert Oppenheimer, head of the Manhattan Project, who is pictured here, and considered to be the father of the atom bomb, to recall verses from the Hindu scripture Bhagavad Gita. If the radiance of 1,000 suns were to burst at once into the sky, that would be the splendor of the Mighty One. I am become death, the destroyer of worlds. The Doomsday Clock is a symbol that represents the likelihood of a human-made global catastrophe. Maintained since 1947 by the members of the Bulletin of the Atomic Scientists who were connected to the Manhattan Project, the clock is a metaphor for threats to humanity from unchecked scientific and technical advances. The clock represents the hypothetical global catastrophe as midnight, and the Bulletin's opinion on how close the world is to a global catastrophe as a number of minutes or seconds to midnight, assessed in January of each year. The main factors influencing the clock are nuclear risk and climate change. The clock's original setting in 1947 was 7 minutes to midnight. It has been set backward and forward 24 times since, the largest ever number of minutes to midnight being 17 in 1991, and the smallest 100 seconds in 2020 and 2021. In 1949, after the Soviets detonated its first nuclear bomb, heralding the start of the nuclear arms race, the Doomsday Clock was set at 3 minutes to midnight. The clock was set at 2 minutes to midnight in January 2018 and left unchanged in 2019. In January 2020, it was moved forward to 100 seconds before midnight, the closest it had been since its inception in 1947. This was primarily due to climate change and the increased threat of nuclear war with North Korea's testing of nuclear weapons, and provocative actions by then US President Donald Trump. In January 2021, the clock setting was left unchanged. Only days after the bombing of the Hiroshima atom bomb atom bomb dancers appeared in Los Angeles theaters while the Washington Press Club sold an atomic cocktail. In New York City, a jewelry store even advertised Bursting Fury, atomic-inspired pin and earring. New fields to conquer with atomic jewelry. The pearl bomb bursts into a fury of dazzling colors in mock rhinestones, emeralds, rubies, and sapphires. As daring to wear as it was to drop the first atom bomb. Hollywood filmmakers hurried to include the atomic bomb in their movies. The House on 92nd Street, released in September 1945, was the first briefly mentioning Process 97, the secret ingredient of the atomic bomb. 1947 also saw the release of The Beginning or the End, which told the story of the Manhattan Project, albeit with wildly inaccurate scientific details as atomic secrets were at the time still classified. The bomb quickly appeared in music as well. In December 1945, Carl and Harty recorded When the Atom Bomb Fell, the first bomb about the atomic bomb to be released. The song reflected newfound American power. It goes, "Oh, it went up so loud, it divided up the clouds, and the houses did vanish away. And a ball of light filled the Japanese with fright. They must have thought it was their judgment day. Smoke and fire did flow through the land of Tokyo. There was brimstone and dust everywhere. When it cleared away, there the cruel Japs did lay. The answer to our fighting boys' prayers. Yes, Lord, the answer to our fighting boys' prayers." In 1957, the Five Stars released the hit song Atom Bomb Baby, which used the bomb as a metaphor for sexuality. The atomic bomb also emerged in comic books. In a comic from October 1946, Superman drinks a poison to save Lois Lane, making him temporarily insane. He then accidentally flies into the atomic bomb test at Bikini Atoll, clearing his head. Now, the Bikini Atoll test also had an important role in influencing fashion. In June 1946, French designer Jacques Haim unveiled a new swimsuit called the Atom, which he advertised as the world's smallest bathing suit. His competitor, Louis Rayard, countered in July with the Bikini, named for the site of the tests conducted only a month earlier in the Marshall Islands. Rayard advertised his swimsuit as smaller than the world's smallest bathing suit. The atomic craze eventually expanded to include tourism. In 1951, the United States began conducting nuclear tests in Nevada, roughly 100 kilometers from Las Vegas, which as a result became an attractive tourist destination. Dawn parties were held at casinos for visitors to stay up to see the tests, while the Nevada Chamber of Commerce gave out calendars which listed the upcoming schedule. Pinups were sold of Miss Atomic Blast, who radiated loveliness instead of deadly atomic particles. Beauty pageants were even held to crown Miss Atomic Bomb, with the winner dressed in a fluffy white dress shaped like a mushroom cloud. From 1945 to 1963, the US detonated 317 nuclear weapons above ground, of which 207 were in Nevada and the remainder in the Pacific. In addition, approximately 235,000 military personnel participated at one of the 230 above ground nuclear weapons tests in the United States. At the Nevada test, or the NTS, these soldiers participated in military maneuvers, observed nuclear weapons tests, or provided technical support. At the Pacific Proving Ground, or the APP, they served aboard ships or were stationed on islands during or after nuclear weapons tests. These personnel were referred to as atomic soldiers. Similarly, the term downwinders was denoted to individuals and communities in the US Midwest between the Cascade and Rocky Mountain ranges who were exposed to radioactive contamination or nuclear fallout from atmospheric nuclear weapons testing and nuclear accidents. They lived in the immediate path of prevailing winds and hence fallout from the NTS. In a bid to downplay the adverse effects of the nuclear tests conducted at the NTS on the downwinders and the environment, the Atomic Energy Commission, or the AEC, created the narrative of a benign bomb. The AEC assured Americans that bombs exploded at the NTS posed no threat, but in order to combat the Soviet nuclear weapons, the US required a massive arsenal and a willingness to engage in nuclear war. While the US government minimized the dangers of fallout and even claimed to be working to eliminate fallout from nuclear weapons, it welcomed fallout as a military instrument. As a result, by the late 1950s, the AEC's credibility was damaged on the question of fallout. Americans began to realize that their own weapons were just as menacing as those of their enemies. This realization crept into American cultural memory as early as 1946. In Theodore Sturgeon's 1946 short story Memorial, the main character, a scientist, wants an end to the scream and crash of bombs and the soporific beat of marching feet. So he ultimately sets off an atomic bomb as a warning of the misuse of great power. The same year, physicist Louis Rodiner wrote Pilot Lights of the Apocalypse, a one-act play in which the United States puts thousands of atomic bombs into satellite orbit, only to discover that many others are already circling the Earth. A chain of nuclear destruction follows. Warnings about the bomb also appeared in poetry, such as William Rose Benet's God's Fire. Here follows an excerpt. Raging inferno, consuming lava pit, fury of flame with life's foundation split. Time was, time is, how fatefully the sound. Time shall be, tolls, Prometheus is unbound. Among the most iconic works of the period was science fiction writer Ray Bradbury's The Martian Chronicles, originally published from 1946 to 1950 as a collection of short stories. In The Watchers, human colonizers on Mars watch as Earth seems to explode, catch fire, and burn. A short time later, they see great Morse code flashes which transmit the message, Australian continent atomized in premature explosion of atomic stockpile. Los Angeles, London bombed. War. Come home. Come home. Come home. The Martian Chronicles was read across the United States and has appeared in film, radio, television, comics, and even an opera. In 1951, the classic film The Day the Earth Stood Still was released. In the film, an alien, Klaatu, comes in a flying saucer to Washington, D.C. In his first appearance, Klaatu announces, "We have come to visit you in peace and with goodwill," but is promptly shot by an officer in the United States Army. In a speech later in the movie, Klaatu explains why he has come to visit Earth. The universe grows smaller every day and the threat of aggression by any group, anywhere, can no longer be tolerated. There must be security for all, or no one is secure. Now, this does not mean giving up any freedom, except the freedom to act irresponsibly. It is no concern of ours how you run your own planet, but if you threaten to extend your violence, this Earth of yours will be reduced to a burnt-out cinder. Your choice is simple. Join us and live in peace, or pursue your present course and face obliteration. We shall be waiting for your answer. The decision rests with you. The fear of atomic destruction would only grow more pronounced in popular culture for the years to come. On the 1st of March 1954, the United States tested its largest bomb ever, Castle Bravo. After the explosion, the wind spread radioactive particles east, affecting several inhabited atolls. U.S. sailors observing the test and servicemen stationed on Rongeryk Atoll were also exposed to radiation. Furthermore, fallout reached a Japanese fishing boat named Daigo Fukuryu Maru, or Fifth Lucky Dragon, located approximately 130 kilometers east of the test site. All 23 members of the crew were exposed to radiation, and they brought irradiated fish back to Japan, causing a panic. The Castle Bravo tests had a marked effect on atomic culture by popularizing the term fallout, a word not used even by scientists until 1948 to describe the radioactive particles caused by a nuclear explosion. Also in 1954, the first Godzilla film, directed by Ishiro Honda, was released in Japan. The story follows the giant monster Godzilla, who is disturbed from his deep ocean sleep by hydrogen bomb testing and begins to attack Japan. As producer Tomoyuki Tanaka would explain, the theme of the film from the beginning was the terror of the bomb. Mankind had created the bomb, and now nature was going to take revenge on mankind. Godzilla has remained a cultural icon, appearing in more than 30 films, including 3 from Hollywood, as well as in television, literature, comics, and video games. Mutant creatures also appeared in American popular culture. Another film from 1954 called Them features giant mutant ants in New Mexico, where it's discovered that they are the product of radiation from Los Alamos. In Attack of the Crab Monsters of 1957, scientists studying radiation on an island are attacked by giant mutant crabs. Even Alfred Hitchcock's classic horror film, The Birds of 1963, in which flocks of killer birds attack humans, also reflects on nuclear fear, even if it's not so overtly. Hitchcock later spoke of the movie's characters as victims of Judgment Day, and as in Godzilla, warned not to mess about or tamper with nature. However, not all mutants of the Fallout era were portrayed as menacing. The comic book series The Fantastic Four, about a superhero team who gained their powers after radiation exposure in outer space, first appeared in 1961. In 1962, Spider-Man appears for the first time in comics. When a spider falls into teenager Peter Parker's radioactive ray gun and bites him, he gains extraordinary powers. Spider-Man's enemy is nuclear scientist Dr. Otto Octavius, who, after having tentacles welded onto his body during an atomic accident, becomes Dr. Octopus, or Doc Ock. The same year, Marvel released the first issue of The Incredible Hulk, in which Dr. Bruce Banner is transformed after exposure to radiation. A different theme of the Fallout era in popular culture was Atomic Armageddon. Neville Shute's novel On the Beach was published in 1957 and made into a film in 1959. The story opens after a nuclear war has devastated most of the world. The only safe place left is Australia, and radioactive fallout will reach it in a matter of months. Faced with certain death, the characters struggle to find meaning in their lives. One young woman protests, "It's not fair. No one in the Southern Hemisphere ever dropped a bomb, a hydrogen bomb, or a cobalt bomb, or any other sort of bomb. We had nothing to do with it. Why should we have to die because other countries 9 or 10,000 miles away from us wanted to have a war? It's so bloody unfair." The US government denied there were sufficient nuclear devices to cause the extinction of humankind. The film was nominated for 2 Academy Awards. The 1964 film Failsafe deals with the issue of nuclear crisis in government. In the movie, American planes armed with nuclear weapons circle the Soviet Union, a strategy for second strike capabilities that was actually used at the time. When they don't stop at their failsafe points due to an electronic error, nuclear war seems imminent. The American president, played by Henry Fonda, tries to stop them and ultimately orders the bombing of New York City to prove to the Soviets that it was a mistake. Failsafe was later remade in 2000 starring George Clooney. The Age of Fallout also saw the rise of civil defense, the training of civilians to be prepared in the event of an attack. This notion was encouraged by the US government and by American popular culture. After the US tested its first hydrogen bomb on the 1st of November 1952, Newsweek reported all the reports and all the statistics added up to one grim conclusion. In an atomic attack, the front would be everywhere. Every home, every factory, every school might be the target. Nobody would be secure in the H-bomb age. In response to this threat, the government encouraged the American public to build fallout shelters in case of a nuclear attack. In a 1961 radio address, President John F. Kennedy asserted, "In the event of an attack, the lives of those families which are not hit in a nuclear blast and fire can still be saved, if they can be warned to take shelter and if that shelter is available. We owe that kind of insurances to our families and to our country." In addition, a special pamphlet called How to Survive an Atomic Bomb was published by the US government printing office in 1950, 1 year after the Soviet Union detonated their first nuclear bomb. The pamphlet explains how to protect yourself, one's food and water supply, as well as one's home. It also covered how to prevent burns and what to do if exposed to radiation. But it was published before accurate results of studies examining the effects of radiation could have on the body were released. Be that as it may, it spawned a spate of independent and official civil defense publications. The government also created numerous short civil defense films, including so-called Training for Children. Although it predated the Age of Fallout, this duck and cover of 1952, an excerpt of which featured in the beginning of this lecture, featured the animated cartoon of Bert the Turtle, a so-called icon of the civil defense era. Children practice duck and cover exercises regularly in school. Civil defense also made its way to Hollywood. During the cabinet meeting in December 1961, Leo Hu, the federal administrator of civil defense, criticized the film On the Beach as very harmful because it produced a feeling of utter hopelessness, thus undermining Office of Civil Defense Management's efforts to encourage preparedness. State Department and US Information Agency analysis added that its strong emotional appeal for banning nuclear weapons could conceivably lead audiences to think in terms of radical solutions rather than practical safeguarded disarmament measures. During the Berlin Crisis of 1961, President Kennedy, addressing the American people, mentioned the creation of the National Emergency Alarm Repeater, or NEAR, Household Warning System. This sparked a hysterical reaction with those able to afford constructing family fallout shelters. Civil defense was promised on the notion that it was possible to survive nuclear war, and fallout shelters were instrumental in perpetuating such a myth. Those outside the shelter were viewed as enemies against whom self-defense was justified. Survival was depicted as an isolating experience in which individuals or families waited in their shelters for days, emerging only when commanded to do so by authorities who monitored radiation levels and restored order. Thus, the US government preferred Hollywood films such as Panic in the Year Zero of 1962. In the movie, the Baldwin family is going on a trip when they see strange flashes of light and they hear via CONORAD, or Control of Electronic Radiation, the emergency broadcast system used during this era, that Los Angeles has been bombed. The father knows what to do in this emergency. He gathers supplies quickly, gets off the road, and keeps his family safe. At the end, the family is stopped by men with machine guns who turn out to be the US military, and the family is then saved by the US government. During the Cold War, a backlash appeared against the idea that preparedness in the form of civil defense could protect the United States from an atom attack. Satirist Tom Lehrer, for example, wrote the song We'll All Go Together When We Go in 1959. A part of it goes as follows. No more ashes, no more sackcloth, and an armband made of black cloth. Will someday never more adorn the sleeve, for if the bomb that drops on you gets your friends and neighbors too, there'll be nobody left behind to grieve. In 1962, singer-songwriter Bob Dylan wrote Let Me Die in My Footsteps, which was omitted from the Freewheeling Bob Dylan album. Michael Gray calls this Dylan's anti-nuclear panic song. The song was intended to deride the Kennedy administration's fallout shelter program that was supposed to enable Americans who took the necessary precautions and followed the prescribed drills to survive nuclear war. The second verse of Dylan's song goes as follows. There's been rumors of war and wars that have been. The meaning of life has been lost in the wind. And some people thinking that end is close by. Instead of learning to live, they are learning to die. Let me die in my footsteps before I go under the ground. The first line takes its cue from the words of attributed to Jesus. And when ye shall hear of wars and rumors of wars, be not troubled. These words, taken from Matthew 24, verse 6, and Luke 13, verse 7, were uttered by Jesus whilst assuring his disciples that such signs heralded the kingdom of God. However, Dylan indicates that he would prefer to die while living life to the full than carry on a subterranean existence in the shadow of nuclear holocaust. In the final verse, he exhorts listeners to join him in condemning the military-industrial complex that promotes nuclear war. His sentiments fly in the face of those who believe that a post-apocalyptic wasteland could be survived and the earth renewed. In 1960, physicist and military strategist at the RAND Corporation, Hermann Kahn, published On Thermonuclear War. It's a controversial treatise on the nature and theory of war in the thermonuclear weapon age. In it, Kahn addresses the strategic doctrines of nuclear war and its effect on the international balance of power. Kahn introduced the doomsday machine as a rhetorical device to show the limits of the US government's strategy of mutually assured destruction, or MAD. Now, mutually assured destruction is a doctrine of military strategy and national security policy in which a full-scale use of nuclear weapons by two or more opposing sides would cause the complete annihilation of both the attacker and the defender. It's based on the theory of deterrence, which posits that the threat of using strong weapons against the enemy prevents the enemy's own use of those same weapons. Kahn thus warns that the aggressor would be committing global suicide by launching the first attack. Still, the US Department of Defense adopted MAD as the best form of deterrence. Now, no work better exemplified the pushback against civil defense than Stanley Kubrick's 1964 black comedy Dr. Strangelove, or How I Learned to Stop Worrying and Love the Bomb, an adaptation of Peter George's novel Red Alert. It stars British actor Peter Sellers as Dr. Strangelove, President Merkin Muffley, and Group Captain Lionel Mandrake. As with Failsafe, the story centers around a nuclear crisis after American planes are inadvertently sent to attack the Soviet Union. It's revealed that the Soviets have a doomsday machine set to attack the United States should the Americans launch a first strike, and it cannot be disabled for any reason. The film openly mocks US government policy, including deterrence theory. The title character, Dr. Strangelove, is an ex-Nazi nuclear advisor, loosely based on Kahn and Werner von Braun, a German physicist who developed rockets for the Nazis during World War II and later came to work for the United States. As Dr. Strangelove explains, deterrence is the art of producing in the mind of the enemy the fear to attack, and so Because of the automated and irrevocable decision-making process which rules out human meddling, the Doomsday Machine is terrifying, simple to understand, and completely convincing. The final minutes of the film also mock the idea that fallout shelters could be used to survive nuclear war. Dr. Strangelove suggests building deep mineshafts to survive, with a 10 to 1 female to male ratio in order to repopulate, while one of the generals warns that the Soviets could do the same, potentially creating a mineshaft gap, a reference to the feared missile gap between the American and Soviet nuclear forces. The movie ends with footage of American nuclear tests while Vera Lynn's "We'll Meet Again" plays. Dr. Strangelove became a cultural icon and received 4 Academy Award nominations, including Best Director for Kubrick, and was selected by the Library of Congress for preservation in the National Film Registry in 1989. Now, at one level, the film is about humanity's capacity for self-destruction when technology is in the hands of power-hungry, fallible leaders. At another level, it's about erotic displacement that substitutes death for desire or violence for love. Kubrick's fetishization of weapons amounts to a satirical attack on the obscenity of American power. Dr. Strangelove's cult status made it a firm favorite of the intelligentsia and campus circuits. It also contributed a critical view to public discourse about the prospects of accidental nuclear warfare. The late 1960s and 1970s saw a decline of nuclear themes in American popular culture. In 1959, 64% of Americans felt that nuclear war was the most pressing issue in the US. But by 1964, that number had dropped to just 16%. The successful negotiation of the 1962 Cuban Missile Crisis and the subsequent establishment of a permanent White House to Kremlin hotline, as well as the 1963 Partial Nuclear Test Ban Treaty and the distraction of the Vietnam War, were all contributing factors to this phenomenon. Nevertheless, atomic culture returned in earnest along with Cold War tensions under the presidency of Ronald Reagan during the 1980s. Films imagining nuclear war were once again produced, such as World War III of 1982, The Day After of 1983, Testament, also of 1983, The Dead Zone, also of 1983, Countdown to Looking Glass of 1984, When the Wind Blows, 1986, and Miracle Mile of 1988. The 1984 best-selling novel The Hunt for Red October, later adapted into a movie starring Sean Connery and Alec Baldwin, tells the story of a Soviet submarine captain who realizes his submarine is going to launch a first nuclear strike and thus tries to defect and stop nuclear war. Other works were more openly critical of the Reagan-era policies. Musicians such as James Taylor, Bonnie Raitt, Bruce Springsteen, and Jackson Brown collaborated on the 1980 concert film No Nukes. The 1980s also saw elements of nuclear nostalgia. There was a renewed interest in the Manhattan Project, with 1985 marking the 40th anniversary of the Trinity test and the bombings of Hiroshima and Nagasaki, resulting in the production of films such as Day One of 1989 and Fat Man and Little Boy, also of 1989. Now, it was during this time that the documentary The Atomic Cafe was released. The film was produced by Kevin and Pierce Rafferty and Jane Roder. It covers the beginnings of the era of nuclear warfare, created from a broad range of archival material from the 1940s, 1950s, and early 60s, including newsreel clips, television news footage, US government-produced films, including military training films, advertisements, television and radio programs, and it has no voice-over narration, nor any new footage. But through its placement of archival footage coupled with its soundtrack, it parodies the US government propaganda and disinformation. The Atomic Cafe was also released during the Reagan administration's forced civil defense revival. Barry Posen and Stephen Van Evera argue that in 1981 to 82, the Reagan administration was moving from an essentially defensive grand strategy of containment to a more offensive strategy. Due to the greater demands of its more offensive strategy, the Reagan administration proposed the biggest military buildup since the Korean War. The Reagan move toward offense included the adoption of a more aggressive nuclear strategy that required a large US nuclear buildup. Containment only required that US strategic nuclear forces be capable of one mission, inflicting unacceptable damage on the Soviet Union, even after the absorbing and all-out Soviet surprise attack. The Reagan administration added a second counterforce mission, which required the capacity to launch a preemptive nuclear strike against Soviet strategic nuclear forces that would leave the Soviets unable to inflict unacceptable damage on the US in retaliation. Thus, the release of the Atomic Cafe as satirical commentary to the US's nuclear arms strategies came at just the right time. In conclusion, we have seen that nuclear weapons heralded a new age of thinking and changed the trajectory of collective memory forever. In the beginning, public reactions varied, but in general, the American public paid little heed to the continuing nuclear arms buildup. They were constantly reassured by authorities that the nuclear threat could and would be handled. Government-backed propaganda and disinformation ensured that people were lulled into a false sense of security. However, there was a counterculture that developed in response to the official narrative. By the early 1960s, the topic of nuclear war and its implications had been exploited to such an extent that it had lost its appeal. But the fascination with the bomb was still evident, especially in the 1980s when the Reagan administration brought the threat of nuclear war back into public consciousness. The nuclear nostalgia, which began in the late 1980s, has continued to the present day. This can be seen, for example, in the popular long-running television show The Simpsons, where Homer Simpson works at a nuclear power plant, and Blinky, the three-eyed fish, which is a product of nuclear waste from the plant, appears frequently. Movie remakes of comic book classics such as Spider-Man of 2002, The Incredible Hulk of 2004, and The Fantastic Four of 2015 have also marked the modern era. Since the end of the Cold War, other works have reflected on different types of apocalypse. One example of this is the 1996 science fiction movie Independence Day, which won the Academy Award for Best Visual Effects and was at the time the second highest grossing film of all time, earning over 800 million US dollars. In the film, humans must band together to fight alien invaders. As producer Dean Devlin noted, our movie is pretty obvious. The closest we get to a social statement is to play upon the idea that as we approach the millennium and we're no longer worried about a nuclear threat, the question is, will there be an apocalypse? And if so, how will it come? The theme of nuclear terrorism has also appeared frequently during the last two decades. In Austin Powers' International Man of Mystery of 1996, Dr. Evil quips, "Oh hell, let's just do what we always do. Let's hijack some nuclear weapon and hold the world hostage." Other films have also addressed the issue, but more seriously, such as The Peacemaker of 1997, the James Bond film The World Is Not Enough of 1999, and The Sum of All Fears of 2001. The prospect of nuclear war still lingers in the works of popular music artists, among others artists such as Iron Maiden, Mark Owen from the band Take That, Radiohead, and the Postal Service have all released highly regarded songs since 2000 expressing anxiety, outrage, and ominous submission to nuclear war. Atomic culture in the US will without a doubt continue to develop in the future and will likely never disappear entirely. Recent films such as The Avengers of 2012 and Pacific Rim of 2013 demonstrate a continued cultural interest in all things nuclear. Renewed tensions with Russia, as well as the nuclear threat from North Korea, may also very well make their way into the current atomic culture in years to come. Next time, we will tackle the issue of racism and sexism in cinema during the mid-20th century and attempts by Hollywood to address racial and gender representation in film.
I will not go down under the ground, because someone tells me that death's coming around. I will not carry myself down to die. If I die, let me die with my head held high. Let me die in my footsteps before I'll go down under the ground. There's been rumors of wars, and wars that have been. The meaning of life has been lost in the wind. Some people are thinking that the end is close by. Instead of learning to live, they are learning to die. Let me die in my footsteps before I go down under the ground. Well, I don't know if I'm smart, but I think I can see when someone is pulling the wool over me. And if there's a war and death comes around, let me die on this earth, for I'll die underground. Let me die in my footsteps before I go down under the ground. Now there's always been people that have cause to fear. They've been talking about wars for many a long year. I've read all their statements, I've not said a word. But now, Lord God, let my poor voice be heard. Let me die in my footsteps before I go down under the ground. If I had riches and rubies and crowns, I'd buy the whole world and I'd change things around. I'd throw all the tanks and the guns in the sea, for they're the mistakes of our past history. Let me die in my footsteps before I go down under the ground. Let me drink from the waters where the mountain streams flood. Let the smell of wild flowers flow free through my blood. Let me sleep in the meadows with your green grassy leaves. Let me walk down the highway with my brothers in peace. Let me die in my footsteps before I go down under the ground. Go out in the country where the land meets the sun. See the craters and the canyons and the wild waters run. Nevada, New Mexico, Arizona, Idaho. Let every state in the Union seep deep in your soul. Then you'll die in your footsteps before you go down under the ground.